This video is brought to you by Audible. Ocean currents and tides are an enormous amount of renewable energy that's just waiting to be harvested. With tidal power, we don't have to rely on building massive dams and waterways that disrupt the environment in order to capture that power. And even though visions of underwater bladed turbines might pop into your head, there's some other technologies that may surprise you, like an undulating membrane that produces electricity, or an underwater kite. Gives the phrase, go fly a kite, a whole new meaning. Let's explore some interesting alternatives for harnessing the power of tides that may be coming our way. I'm Matt Ferrell. Welcome to Undecided. Believe it or not, harnessing the power of tides isn't something new. Back to the Middle Ages, tide mills were mainly used to grind grains, and obviously, there was no electricity generation at all. Now in England, for example, there's a tide mill that dates back to 1170. At that time, they would build a barrage across the opening of a basin so that one side of the basin could fill while the tide was rising. Once the tide dropped, the water was impounded before releasing it through a water wheel. But it was only in the 19th century that utilizing tides to produce electricity started to be considered. In 1924, the US Federal Power Commission carried out a study for installing tidal power plants in Maine and New Brunswick. In 1956, Nova Scotia Light and Power of Halifax also commissioned tidal power studies. But it was the French who built the first tidal barrage at commercial scale in Rance Estuary near Saint-Malo, France, in 1965. And according to the International Renewable Energy Agency, since the 1960s, only 5 projects have been developed commercially up to 2012. But the number of full-scale projects and new technologies that don't require a huge dam have advanced significantly over the past few years. There are 3 main ways to harness the energy from tides and currents in a body of water: tidal barrages, tidal fences, and tidal turbines. Tidal barrages are very similar to hydroelectric dams. The barrage is attached to the seafloor, and its top is just slightly above the level that water hits during its highest tide. During an incoming high tide, water flows over the turbines as the water goes up. Then the water flows back through the turbines as it becomes low tide, producing the electricity. Now, although tidal barrages are the most efficient way to harness tidal energy, they're the most costly, and there are several concerns regarding their environmental impact. Tidal barrages change the movement of water and fish into and out of estuaries, which can impact some marine species. They can also change the structure of the coast and cause erosion of dunes and other habitats. Another type is tidal turbines, which is similar to wind turbines, but you probably guessed, they're submerged underwater. And since water is denser than air, these turbines can generate more electricity than wind power plants, but it also results in higher manufacturing costs since they need to withstand stronger tides. They can also have a negative effect on marine life, causing the death of animals, emit lots of noise, and take up considerable area of seabed. The last type of tidal power is fences, which is like a hybrid between barrages and turbines, but these turbines are positioned in a fence-like structure and spin like a turnstile. This type of power plant produces electricity from tidal currents that push the turbine blades, which are attached to a generator. They're installed entirely underwater, and even though they don't require large, concrete structures like barrages, they can still have a negative effect on marine life. Although tidal power is a renewable, zero-carbon emissions, predictable energy source that can produce a high amount of power output, just like any other power source, it has its disadvantages. Currently, there are limited installation sites, it's expensive, and as I've mentioned, it can negatively impact the surrounding ecosystem. But there are several companies researching and developing new technologies to reduce those problems. But before I get to that, if you want to be impressed by some creative problem solving, check out the audiobook Project Hail Mary by Andy Weir from Audible. Just like his book The Martian, Project Hail Mary centers around one character using his knowledge of science and creative thinking to solve some extremely complex challenges, some very otherworldly challenges. Now, I talk a lot about technologies that can help combat climate change, and not to give anything away, they have to deal with that exact issue in the book at one point. It's a gripping and inspiring book. If you're like me, it'll probably grab you too. Now, I've been an Audible subscriber forever, seriously. I listen to audiobooks when driving, walking the dog, mowing the lawn, you name it. They have everything from nonfiction to fiction. They even have podcasts. With the subscription, you get 1 credit every month to use on any title, which are yours to keep forever. And there are thousands of titles and series to choose from, and being able to listen on the go while doing some chores really makes your day so much more enjoyable. I absolutely love it. Now, if you want to listen to Project Hail Mary or any of their audiobooks, go to audible.com/undecided or text undecided to 500-500. Best part is that you can try Audible for free for 30 days. Thanks to Audible and to all of you for supporting the channel. So getting back to the companies researching and developing new technologies to reduce those problems. The Scottish company Sustainable Marine has developed the Plat-1 technology, which is an innovative floating tidal energy system. Their Plat 1 is equipped with 6 in-stream turbines that can generate up to 70 kilowatts, which means the entire platform can deliver 420 kilowatts of power. Its modular design also means it can be shipped to any part of the globe with easy assembly on site. An onboard transformer steps up the voltage before it flows out of the platform towards the shore station through a subsea cable. The company's going to be testing the platform in the Bay of Fundy's Grand Passage site as part of the first phase of the Bembok in-stream Tidal Energy project, which will produce about 9 megawatts of electricity for the Nova Scotia grid. The goal is to reduce 17,000 tons of CO2 equivalents annually and power approximately 3,000 homes. A similar approach has been developed by Orbital Marine Power, which launched its 2-megawatt floating tidal turbine, the Orbital O2, in April of this year. This platform has twin 20-meter rotors on the ends of 18-meter-long articulating arms, which means sweeping more than 600 square meters of area below the surface. Anchors can moor in powerful tidal streams or river currents, and the underwater blades harness the energy from tides. The platform can generate clean, predictable electricity to meet the demand of around 2,000 UK homes, and offset approximately 2,200 tons of CO2 equivalent production per year. The most interesting part is that it can be launched like a ship and float out to its location to be moored, commissioned, and connected to the grid. This 680-ton powerhouse was assembled at the Port of Dundee for the past 18 months. Orbital Marine Power Chief Executive Andrew Scott said, "We've been developing this technology here in the UK for over 15 years. Orbital estimates the levelized cost of electricity for the first 2-megawatt O2 turbine to be under £200 per megawatt hour. Now, this isn't that far off from government investment contracts supporting over 3 gigawatts of installed offshore wind capacity in the UK, which range from £165 to £180 per megawatt hour. The turbine arrived in Orkney Waters on April 24th and is now being prepared for installation at the European Marine Energy Center. This is the third orbital turbine that EMEC will be testing, but the O2 is the first one that's a commercial demonstrator plant. If this works out, they'll be moving to commercial sales of the technology. Now, Orbital claims the design as the most powerful tidal turbine in the world, but it turns out that another particular design can also produce a great amount of power. The undulating membrane produced by Eel Energy can provide up to 5 megawatts of clean, renewable energy. It's something that kind of looks like a whale's tail swimming underwater. In this case, energy is converted all over the membrane surface. It undulates as fluid flows through it, generating a periodic motion converted into electricity by an electromechanical system. It also uses a monitoring loop to boost energy conversion as the flow and power change during the operation. The benefits of this design are a low drag force, reduced dimensions compared to the power it can deliver, and it automatically orients itself to capture 100% of the current. And the minimum area required for installation is 10 times smaller than wind turbines. One downside, it sounds like it's still a ways out for production. Prototype tests for industrial production were scheduled for 2020, but there's no new information. Now, jumping over to another exciting alternative, what about a kite that generates electricity by flying underwater? Yes, it does sound a little weird, but it's real. The concept of the Deep Green Ocean Energy Power Plant, which was patented by Minesto, is something that I don't think most people would have come up with. Unlike any of the other tidal turbines, this one has wings that push the turbine through the water in a figure-8-shaped pattern, covering a large area at a relative speed that is several times faster than the actual speed of the underwater current. This makes it a great alternative to harness low-flow tidal streams and ocean currents. But how does it actually work? The wing uses hydrodynamic lifting force created by the underwater current to move the kite. An onboard control system and rudders steer the kite autonomously in that figure-8 trajectory, pushing the turbine through the water. Since the power produced by this unusual power plant has a cubic relationship to its velocity, speeding up the turbine makes the generated electricity several hundred times greater compared to if it was stationary. The turbine is connected to a generator that provides electricity through a power cable in the tether. Then a seabed power cable transfers the electricity to the onshore station. The company has 2 product lines to provide some flexibility. The Deep Green Microgrid focuses on project developers, island economies, and aquaculture developers. It's geared more towards remote users and has a rated power from 50 to 250 kilowatts. It weighs between 1 and 3 tons with wings that range between 4 and 6 meters, and the depth of installation is lower than 60 meters. Minesto also offers the Deep Green Utility, which focuses on customers like utilities, project developers, and power producers. This is a more powerful tidal power plant and can produce between 500 kilowatts to 3 megawatts, and weighs between 10 and 35 tons, with wings between 12 and 24 meters, and it's also installed deeper than 60 meters. Now, according to the company, Deep Green is the only known technology to cost-effectively produce electricity at sites with speeds between 1.2 and 2.4 meters per second, and depths more than 60 meters. Its small size is a potential advantage since it's up to 15 times less per megawatt than competing technologies. In October of 2020, Monesto installed its first 100-kilowatt DG100 tidal kite system in the northwest part of the Faroe Islands. Monesto has been granted public funding totaling approximately about 3.5 million euros by the EU's EIC Accelerator and the Swedish Energy Agency for the development of the project. The system has been delivering power to the grid since December of 2020. They've also started to develop and build the Holyhead Deep site in North Wales. Once it's fully installed, a 10-megawatt deep green array will produce local and clean electricity with the equivalent of 8,000 households. They plan to increase the site to deliver 80 megawatts, which would increase that figure to almost 70,000 households. But how much does it cost? According to the company, Monesto's levelized cost of energy will fall to 100 euros per megawatt hour after 100 megawatts of installed capacity in tidal streams. Although the market of tidal energy is still small compared to other renewables, the global market for wave and tidal energy was estimated at $542 million in 2020, and is projected to reach over $5.1 billion by 2027, which is a growth rate of 37.7%. This growth can come with technology advancement, government grants, as well as green policies. For example, in September of 2020, Canada announced a $9.4 million investment in four tidal energy projects that are going to be installed in the Atlantic region. The development of tidal power can also contribute to other carbon-free technologies. For example, electric vehicles on the island of Yell in Shetland, Scotland, can now be charged entirely by Nova Innovation's tidal turbines. These turbines have been powering homes and businesses in Shetland for more than 5 years, and now the island's vehicles can be powered purely by the tide. Although tidal energy has been stepping up slowly compared to solar and wind, it's evident that this power source has great potential. A kite that generates power from low-flow tides, an undulating membrane that can produce up to 5 megawatts, and huge tidal power platforms are just a few examples of what could come. So what do you think? Do you think any of these will catch on? And any other tidal technologies that I should look into? Jump in the comments and let me know. If you like this video, be sure to check out one of the ones I've linked to right here. Be sure to subscribe and hit that notification bell if you think I've earned it. And as always, thanks to all of my patrons for helping to support the channel and making these videos possible. And a big welcome to new producer, Gray Hilliard. And of course, thanks to all of you for watching. I'll see you in the next one.